resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die.
Welcome, everyone. My name is Reverend Jill Caldwell. I'll be leading this service, which is a thanksgiving for the life of Mary Ellis, a strong, independent woman, and yet someone with a huge number of friends, and who was always Auntie Mary to her family and many others. True to form, much of what you'll hear today was chosen by Mary herself. And it is a privilege, alongside her family, to help fulfill those wishes. So the first hymn that Mary has chosen is "Dear Lord and Father of Mankind." Let's stand to sing.
Thank you. Please be seated. Can you hear me? So I have the privilege of reading the tribute to Mary, written by her nephew Richard, and with contributions from across the family and her friends in Bookham and at this church where she was very well known. So let us begin. For babies born in 1924, there was little chance of living to celebrate your 99th birthday. For children born today, it's a 1 in 3 chance. But Mary Ellis, who made it to 99 2/3, was no ordinary baby. She was an extraordinary woman, truly one of a kind. A woman who made her mark in nursing, adults and especially children. Not only in London, but also in Montreal, Canada. She was strong and forthright and independent-minded, yet she made many friends across the world. And these friends went with her on her numerous travels to Russia, Egypt, China, and beyond. And leafing through her address book or glancing at her email inbox, you'd find addresses in the USA, Canada, Spain, Australia, France, and Eastern Europe. She always kept up to speed with news and current affairs, particularly anything to do with her beloved Canada. Mary was very sharp and intelligent. And if she had been an intelligence agent for foreign powers, as some of her family always suspected, she would have been an extremely effective one. Perhaps it's just as well she takes that secret with her. There is a funeral poem called The Lift by the Irish poet Seamus Heaney, because his family had their own Auntie Mary in the form of an unmarried sister. And he wrote these words at her funeral, evoking how, like Mary, she could be independent and proud, and also kind and tender at the same time, and not without great joy and pleasures in her life. The poem reads, "Favorite aunt, good sister, faithful daughter, delicate since childhood, tough alloy of disapproval, tendresse and hauteur. She took the risk at last of certain joys, her bird table and jubilating birds, the fashion in her wardrobe and her tall boy." So Seamus Heaney describes his sister as delicate since childhood, yet made of tough alloy. And indeed, Mary had asthma and various allergies, but also had that inner steeliness alongside a heart of gold. She saw off cancer in her 50s and shrugged off other illnesses too. Mary Ellis was indeed a faithful daughter to Henry and Kathleen, good sister to John and David, favorite aunt to their children, Cecilia, Christopher, Nigel, Penny, Catherine, Richard, and Liz. And she was a great aunt and a godmother and an honorary godmother to so many others. A babysitter for children who grew up and kept in touch, and whose children then stayed in touch with her in their turn. She was truly everybody's Auntie Mary, and so well supported by Mibin, David's wife, and Monica, John's wife, after both her brothers had died. Since she always stayed in touch, Mary has always been a constant in her family's lives. In the 60s, while Mary was living in Canada, she always seemed very exotic whenever she visited England. An English woman alone living abroad at that time was not a common occurrence. She even had to start speaking French in Canada due to Montreal's approach to bilingualism. Her transatlantic twang, her strange phrases about washing up after she'd visited the restroom, Her ability to be Canadian and different, as well as very English at the same time. Maybe all of that contributed to her very un-English ability to strike up conversations with complete strangers and make friends very quickly. Mary showed great compassion and sympathy for suffering older ones, as she called them, among her acquaintance, even though they were often a good 15 years younger than she was. But that empathy, her thoughtfulness, her generosity of spirit, made her a wonderful member of the bereavement team here at St. Nicholas, helping people through difficult times. For many years, she was a member of one of our prayer and Bible groups. She joined the book club, which met at the rectory. And I'm told she would come into this church on a Saturday morning to tidy up for the Sunday services. Indeed, when thinking of Mary, her family remember her as being neat as a pin, always smartly turned out with a crisp blouse, her hair beautifully styled by Karen, her wonderful local hairdresser. She had a no-nonsense air about her. She always told you what she thought, and she recognised truth and respected it. At her 90th birthday celebration, her family spent some time selecting words that described Mary. Most of the family went for things like organised, compassionate, loving, kind and thoughtful, which are all true. However, little Charlie, who would have been about 11 at the time, described her as a bit bossy, which she would have laughed at. Mary had a sense of fun and a love of life. She played tennis and bridge and mahjong. She took up synchronized swimming for a time, and she particularly loved music. She had a long connection with the Yehudi Menuhin School, which is nearby here, and she played piano. Then, in her late 70s, she took up playing the steel drums. She performed on occasion with Pandemonium, which is a local steel pan group well known in Bookham. Mary chose to spend her last few years at Lime Grove in East Horsley, where she received excellent care. Her family are particularly grateful to Agnes, Joe, Teresa, Patrick, and all staff in the Wren unit and the wider Lime Grove team for their continued care for Mary. She was immeasurably helped by her good friends Sue White and Ali Sanguine, and all her friends here at St. Nicholas and in Great Bookham. While she was able, she enjoyed visits to friends, to friendship lunches held here, and especially cream tea at the Vinery's Garden Centre. Her independence was immensely important to her. At one stage, she had a stair lift installed in her home in Bookham. Did she use it? Yes, but only to move the shopping up from the ground floor to the first floor while she ran alongside up the stairs to meet it at the top. Independent, organized, hardworking, with a great sense of duty and faith is how Mary will be remembered. The city of Montreal has a motto, Concordia Salus, well-being through harmony, and the city's symbol is the hard-working beaver, so it's no surprise that Mary and Montreal chose each other and that she loved it to the end. And we now have a reading chosen by Mary from Psalm 138, which will be read by Nigel.
Psalm 138, Thanksgiving and Praise of David. I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I sing your praise. I bow down toward your holy temple and give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and your faithfulness, for you have exalted your name and your word above everything. On the day I called, you answered me. You increased my strength of soul. All the kings of the earth shall praise you, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth. They shall sing the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. For though the Lord is high, He regards the lowly, but the haughty he preserves from far away. Although I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve me against the wrath of my enemies. You stretch out your hand, and your right hand delivers me. The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the work of your hands.
Thank you, Nigel. Beautifully read. Shall we stand together and sing our second hymn, Jerusalem the Golden?
Reading, which will be read by Penny.
Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 to 9, the Beatitudes. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up a mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. And blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God.
Thank you, Penny. Just a short reflection on that Bible reading. I'm sorry you're hearing a lot from me today. Mary has chosen a very famous passage for us to reflect on. It's from the Sermon on the Mount, given by Jesus quite early in his ministry. And as Penny said, it's known as the Beatitudes. A beatitude means blessedness or happiness, and it refers to those who have certain qualities which belong to the kingdom of heaven. Some Bible translations don't say blessed, they say happy. So happy are those who are poor in spirit. It's thought that the passage that Penny has just read to us is not an actual sermon, but written down verbatim, but a collection of sayings brought together from various points in Jesus' ministry. And it's not really a mount. It was not anything like Ben Nevis, more like a hillside, but it's called the Sermon on the Mount. Because probably what Matthew was trying to do was draw a comparison between Jesus giving advice about life, his teachings about life on that mountain, comparing with Moses many centuries before on Mount Sinai giving the Ten Commandments. Those were written on stone and given very dramatically in the mist-shrouded heights of the mountain. So they're very different scenes, and Matthew is telling us a new order is beginning. Because in the past, Jews tried to live a life obeying a set of written rules. It was all about not sinning. Thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness, thou shalt not kill. But Jesus' teaching is different. You notice it's not a set of rules, it's a set of personal qualities. It's not about not sinning, it's about being and the way we are. Blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are the meek, blessed are the peacemakers. Jesus asks those who follow him to develop these qualities, and they're not the normal ones that we in the West tend to value. It's not thou shalt be competitive and amass personal, economic, and political power. It's completely the opposite. Jesus values those who are poor in spirit, which means those who recognize that they are dependent on God. He values those who are humble and don't push themselves forward at the expense of others. He values those who show mercy and can empathize and show compassion to other people. He loves those who strive for justice and for peace. He values those who are not hypocritical, but who are single-minded in their attempts to live a good life and help others. And he has a special heart for those who are grieving. Not only the loss of a loved individual, but also mourning for suffering and misery of others in our world. Can anyone embody all these values in the Beatitudes? It's a very high standard to reach. But you'll notice there are two tenses in each of the Beatitudes. Each starts with the present tense, for example, blessed are those who mourn, followed by a future tense, they will be comforted. We're dealing with two time zones here. The present day, when we try to live as Jesus teaches us, with his help. And then the future, when we go to be with God in his kingdom. Because that's the place where the values expressed in Beatitudes are the norm and not the exception. In choosing this passage, Mary has helped us see a glimpse of how life in God's kingdom starts here with our life on earth and culminates with our life with God in heaven. Should we wait until heaven before we start living out the Beatitudes? No, we should start now, because when we live out heavenly values, we make our world, our lives, a better place. Amen. going to pray now. A prayer chosen by Mary. Lord, our eternal Father, who orderest all things for our eternal good, mercifully enlighten our minds and give us a firm and abiding trust in your love and care. Silence our murmurings, quieten our fears, and dispel our doubts, that rising above our anxieties, we may rest on thee, the rock of everlasting strength. Amen. Eternal God, our life is a fleeting shadow that does not endure. Our years pass quickly, and our days are few and full of trouble. We thank you that Mary no longer has to suffer pain or fear, grappling with death, fighting for life, and that for her, those limitations are ended, weakness is overcome, and death itself is conquered. As she passes from our earthly sight, we thank you for the years of her presence among us. And while we feel the pain of the parting, we rejoice in the faith that she has gone to be with you. For in your presence is the fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Bless those who had the care of her, especially doctors, nurses, family, friends, and carers. We thank you for all those engaged in social care and medical research. May they never lose heart in their work and their search to discover new ways of health and healing, to be better able to help those in need. Lord, we are all human, and a death in the family causes us to reflect not only on good times, but also on times which were difficult. We pray, God of mercy, as we mourn the death of Mary and thank you for her life, we also remember when it was hard for us to understand, to forgive and to be forgiven. Heal our memories of hurt and failure and bring us to forgiveness and life in Jesus Christ our Lord. I pray for Mary's family and friends here today, that in this time of sadness, there will also be time for laughter and joy in their memories of her and the legacy that she leaves behind. Shall we say together the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I'm going to stand and sing our final hymn, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven.
Thank you. morning wave to you. Deep peace of the flowing air to you. Deep peace of the quiet earth to you. Deep peace of the shining stars to you. Deep peace of the gentle night to you. Moon and stars pour their healing light on you. Deep peace of Christ, of Christ, running wave to you. Deep peace of the flowing air to you. Deep peace of the quiet earth to you. Deep peace of the shining stars to you. The gentle night to you. Moon and stars for their healing light on you. Deep peace of Christ, of Christ.
That was a beautiful choice, isn't it? We're coming to the end of our Thanksgiving service for Mary. Just soon we will commend her spirit to God, and there will be a blessing, and then the service will be over. Can I just say that details about making donations to Great Ormond Street are on the back of your service sheet. If you wanted to donate to the church, we have a plate at the back and one of these fancy sum-up machines if you wanted to make a donation. But could you please stand now for the commendation? Mary has fallen asleep in the peace of Christ. As we leave her body here, we entrust her with faith and hope in everlasting life to the love and mercy of our Father, and surround her with our love and prayer. In baptism, she was made by adoption a child of God. At the Eucharist, she was sustained and fed. God now welcomes her to his table in heaven to share in eternal life with all the saints. And as you'd think, Mary has chosen the blessing. The Lord bless you and watch over you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious to you. The Lord look kindly upon you and give you peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
October.